And I think we'll get started here. All right. Good afternoon, everyone, or good evening for our friends in Africa, or good late evening to our friends maybe joining from Asia. It's great to be with you. My name is Rich Belfast. I'm the president and CEO of the International Crane Foundation. And this is a fantastic year because we're celebrating 50 years of conservation impact together. And I'm going to talk today about what some of the things we've learned in those 50 years and how we see the road to the next 50 years. Great opportunity to be with you to talk about that. I have been with the Crane Foundation for a very long time. Some of you have probably seen me on other webinars and other events here. I'm about 35 years, mostly with the Crane Foundation. Started as a graduate student and an intern back in the 80s, and then wore many hats as field ecologist and director of our programs in Africa. And then I came in as CEO about 14 years ago. How the time flies. Well, another person who's been here every day that I've been here and then some is Claire Morandi. Claire is 39 years with the International Crane Foundation, too, has worn many hats and done a tremendous job for us. Well, Claire will be retiring later this year, and I wanted her to join me on this webinar. She'll come in at the end and help with questions, and we'll have a little chat with Claire too towards the end of the hour. And it's always a good chance for me to thank her again for her incredible long service to ICF, topped only by George Archibald, who was, of course, there for all 50 of those 50 years, no surprise to anyone. Anyway, here we go from the field webinar. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping notes. You may be familiar with those. We are recording today, so a link will be posted a few days after the webinar that you can share with your family and friends who weren't able to join us today. If you have questions, please use the Q&A function, and we will get to as many of your questions as possible at the end of the hour here. Claire may answer a couple of the easy ones as we go, and then we'll queue up the rest for our discussion at the end. Look forward to that. And thank you, as always, to our From the Field webinar sponsors. This one is sponsored by Tom and Kathy Leiden. It says intrepid crane enthusiasts. Well, I can say I know Tom and Kathy are down in South Africa right now at a crane meeting, so they are the definition of intrepid crane enthusiasts. If you want to sponsor a webinar, please contact Kate. As always, her contact information is there. We'd love to have your sponsorship. We do these about once a month or so. All right. Well, here we go. 50 years, really an extraordinary thing. I'm going to talk today about 50 years of crane conservation. We're going to reflect back, and we're going to fly forward a little bit of both, talk about some lessons learned over this long period and how we see the future of crane conservation shaping up. Well, sometimes if you've seen other webinars, we do this an important land acknowledgement when we get started. And I want to show you a new slide for our land acknowledgement. I'm so excited. This is the artist, the sculptor, Melanie Talmadge, shown in the middle there. And this is our brand new land acknowledgement piece that we did together with the Ho-Chunk, our immediate neighbors. You'll find it on site if you come visit us. And we're just delighted to have Melanie's beautiful work. But this is an acknowledgement that the Ho-Chunk are our neighbors and occupied the lands that we are on for many millennia here, well, really in a huge part of Wisconsin, northern Illinois, into Minnesota. We're grateful to have the Ho-Chunk as our partners. We have staff who are Ho-Chunk, and we honor their long tradition on the land and look forward to good, strong partnership into the future. So, 50 years. Yeah, I keep saying that because yeah, it's a long time. Well, if you were with us a few weeks back, we were celebrating our annual Members' Day and our 50th anniversary celebration with a big gala. This was the flyer for that gala. It was really a wonderful evening to talk about our history and share some stories. And I've really enjoyed this entire year, kind of talking about what we've learned, what we've thought about, what we've gained from 50 years, where we're going. Well, back in 1973, this is not going to be a history lesson, I promise you, but there we were back in 1973 when George and Ron Sawi, Ron on the left here and George on the right back at the time, founded the International Crane Foundation. We were looking out at a big world of crane conservation back then, and there we were in Baraboo with our little headquarters on the horse farm of the Sawi family right on City View Road in Baraboo. And yeah, it felt like long ago. We had a lot of fun the night of the gala doing a couple of things. One was inviting back up some of the people on the fence here who were some of our very first volunteers at the Crane Foundation working together with George and Ron. That was a lot of fun to bring them up on stage. And then also George and I had a great opportunity to tell some stories from our early days and talk about work that's affected our lives and has helped epitomize some of the work that ICF's done over many, many years. So it was fun to share those stories and show some old pictures of ourselves and all that kind of good stuff. But what I really want to focus on with you today is today, because this is what we look like in 2023. I'm still sitting here in Baraboo at our office today, although I spent a lot of time running around, but we have colleagues and networks and offices and programs all over the world. And this is just a sampling of where we work directly at boots on the ground or with partners in all of these countries around the world and across these states in the United States and up in Canada. We now have offices in Beijing and in Vietnam. We have offices across East Africa and Uganda, Kenya, Rwanda, down in Zambia and South Africa, and of course here in Baraboo, as well as in Texas, and many program partners all over the place. So wow, how we've grown, you might say. We of course have our gorgeous campus here. We did this wonderful remodel the last few years. If you haven't come back to see us in the last couple of years, you really haven't seen us, so please do. As always, you can see these birds up close and personal. It's a wonderful experience. I think our remodel has made it all the better for really appreciating these cranes and where they come from and the work worldwide that we do for crane conservation. And all that work is done by our amazing staff. Oh, we just have a tremendous staff. It is growing and growing and growing. I think we have another 20 staff coming on in the year ahead and just doing wonderful things across the world and from everywhere. Here's just an example. I was in Africa a couple months ago for a team meeting. And this is just our direct staff in Africa working together for conservation in 12 countries across the continent. Just very exciting to be building a team of this quality and this impact around the world. And of course, we do it all with lots of amazing partners everywhere, near and far, some of them global conservation groups, some of them very local conservation partners and community groups, some of our big supporters and all. We've all done it together as a team. And then at the heart of that is of course all of you, our volunteers, our supporters, our members, our directors, everyone who has made our work possible. So much over these 50 years. And well, what have we learned? That's what we're here to talk about today. What have we learned with this amazing team, this amazing geography we've amassed over 50 years, all these great partners and supporters and all of you. So let's reflect a little on 50 years. And the way I wanna do that is to kind of focus on what I'll call sort of the upside and the downside of many of the big issues we've worked on, tell you some of the really great things that have come out of the work, but also kind of reflect on challenges we've faced that we've had to deal with, learn and grow and deal with over the years to try to give you a holistic view of how we think as an organization. So for starters, in case you have to leave early today, I'm going to give you the take-home message. And the take-home message is this: we've flown together, all of us, and really achieved some remarkable successes over the last 50 years. I mean, when you think back to the early 70s and where we've come, a lot of remarkable successes. I'll try to give you a window into those with my talk today. But we have a long way to go. Cranes still need our help. We're not gonna roll it in after 50 years. We're gonna keep going. We'll still be here in another 50 years. And that is all the challenges that the cranes of the world, one of the most endangered family of birds on Earth, and also a species that gives us fantastic opportunities to do conservation, but so many challenges for these birds around the world. So we've done so much together and we still have a long way to go. Well, that's your take home, but let's talk about that in a little more detail here. Let's start with kind of the iconic nature of cranes. Well, certainly something we've learned over the last 50 years is there is a phenomenal cultural reverence for cranes around the world. And it really matters in crane conservation. Well, we know these cranes are elegant, just beyond words, the blue crane in South Africa. They're ancient, you know, when you hear the call of the Sandhill Crane, you know you're listening back to the era, practically back to the dinosaurs. They're so ornate and beautiful, like these crown cranes. So we know that, those that have visited and experienced these birds know that, but here's how some of the many ways it's played out. Well, in Buddhist culture, cranes are one of the most revered species. They're actually one of seven holiest incarnations of Buddha in Buddhist religion. This is the bottom of the foot of sleeping Buddha. And so there's a profound reverence for cranes in Buddhist culture. And that's very good for cranes because we do a lot of work in Buddhist countries. One of which is, and one of the very important places is Lumbini Crane Sanctuary down on the border of Nepal near India. This is the birthplace of Buddha. And believe it or not, we actually lease about a square mile of land at the birthplace of Buddha. The International Crane Foundation holds a lease for about the last 30 years. And we do that to secure Sarath crane habitat in that area and help people who come as pilgrims to these areas experience Sarath cranes as one of the holy species in the life of Buddha. So that's very exciting. Also in that region of Southeast Asia, in the Hindu religion, you equally have a very profound and deep and ancient relationship with Sarath crane. The story of the origin of suffering that's depicted in the Ramayana, the Hindu epic from about 500 BC, 400, 500 BC, it also celebrates the Sarath cranes. And that's meant incredible cultural protection for these birds. I mean, we talk here in Wisconsin, we talk about sandhill cranes living on farms side by side with farmers, but this is at a whole nother level in Buddhist and Hindu cultures where like these enormous Sarath cranes here, 6 foot tall, truly live side by side on farms with these species. And the same down in Vietnam, and you know, quick story there, I started as a graduate student with ICF back in the 80s. And when we were doing our work in Vietnam and trying to learn about these birds, we originally were using the scientific word for the Sarath crane there to try to ask people, you know, have you seen the birds that basically is the giant red-headed bird? And people would look at us and have no idea what we were talking about, even with our Vietnamese colleagues. And then we learn, have you seen the holy bird? The holy bird that takes your soul to heaven, that is the messenger to the gods between the people. Well, people knew all about these birds. The local word for them is hak, and they knew about those birds, and they knew about that deep spiritual connection with the birds. Well, that extends from beyond South and Southeast Asia into the cultures of East Asia, in China, in Korea, in Mongolia, in North and South Korea, all along in Japan. They're depicted in many, many aspects of culture, of course, in the cranes of peace at Hiroshima, in so many depictions of art. There's the classic cranes up in the pine trees, showing the auspiciousness of cranes. You can travel throughout the region in East Asia and see cranes in everything from street signs to sewer caps to buses and garages. And that too has been very good for cranes in a crowded world, cranes living side by side with communities in China, inspiring so much tourism at places like Hokkaido in Japan, and inspiring future generations of conservationists to learn and appreciate these birds, this reverence for the birds. It extends into the continent of Australia, where the Broga, an Aboriginal culture in Australia among the first peoples there, is the source of the origin of the sun in their origin stories. And so it's a revered bird in those cultures too on that continent, and appreciated and protected very strongly culturally. And in Africa, where cranes are the national bird in three countries, you need to look no further than Uganda. Cranes are at the center of the national flag of Uganda and the coat of arms. The national bank is the Crane Access Bank. They're on coins, they're on the fins of the national airline. And of course, the national soccer team is the cranes. Go cranes, go. Well, once again, that's meant very important legal protections and cultural protections across East Africa and in different parts of the continent where different crane species are. Back here at home and where I am sitting, at least currently in North America, cranes go back millennia. They're in pictographs out in the Southwest. This is one from Utah. I've shown this one before. I love this, just going back thousands of years in our connection with cranes. And I love this one. This is a painting that was in Madison. It's from the Red Cliff Band of the Lake Superior Ojibwe. And it's called The Last Watering Hole, Creating a New World. And it's a consultation between the Red Cliff Band and the Crane Clan and the species that are advising in the creation of a new world. And you see a sandhill crane, and they're busy giving the cranes opinions on the need for wetlands and food and all the things they may be looking for in shaping of a new world. And up in Michigan today, you can see the totem for the band and the Sarath crane at the top as an important part of the Crane Clan. So wonderful, deep, old cultural connections. And they play out in so many ways today in our appreciation for the recovery of the sandhill cranes, the way they've come back on our lands. I look around my hometown in Madison, I see crane crossings, I see crane beaches, crane soccer fields. We have crane drains. This is a crane drain that was painted reminding people where their wastewater goes. It's great appreciation. People love having these enormous birds back in their lives, having this connection with them. And likewise, of course, the iconic whooping crane, when the Endangered Species was created, sorry, Endangered Species Act was created, which was also 50 years ago. We're celebrating the 1973 adoption of the Endangered Species Act. One of the first species, excuse me, on the act was, of course, the whooping crane. They were one of the iconic species of the Endangered Species Act, and that has fueled so much attention and focus on their recovery. This impressive, tallest flying bird in North America. Of course, we thrilled to the many years with Operation Migration, teaching these birds to migrate. People would come out and see these birds in migration. It captured our imagination of conservation. It inspired, just like in Asia, future generations of people to learn more about cranes, think more about cranes. And perhaps between the sandhills and the whooping cranes, they've achieved the highest thing you can achieve in our culture. Five beers and counting, five different microbrews that celebrate cranes, and I'm sure we'll be up to 10 in no time. So many ways we connect with these birds. So in Asia, in Australia, in Africa, here in North America, cranes are revered, and that's wonderful. But there are limits to that reverence, as we've learned over the 50 years, and that is we revere cranes a lot less when they actually threaten our livelihoods. And that's been at the center of a lot of challenges in recent years. Here in Wisconsin, there's been a call for a hunting season. A lot of the justification for that hunting season has been associated with crop depredation and crop damage by sandhills. Although we do not feel that hunting is a solution for crop depredation at all. That's a whole other lecture we can talk about here. But there's no doubt that that concern has fueled some of the rise of that. And we see that play out in a much more serious way right now in Asia and Africa, where when cranes feed on crops, they can really threaten the livelihoods of farmers. We have terrible situations where we have endangered cranes, like these gray-crowned cranes, feeding on crops of very poor farmers. And sometimes that leads to terrible incidents like these mass poisonings that have occurred in Uganda, in Kenya, down in Zambia, where people feel threatened by the cranes. So this is a problem we really have to solve, as we'll talk about later, working hand in hand with farmers to find real solutions. But there's no doubt that cranes can maybe be revered culturally, but when they threaten our livelihoods, that's a game changer. And we need to acknowledge that. We have acknowledged that in our history, and that's an important part as we look forward. And sometimes we just revere cranes a little bit too much. That's where illegal trade has been a big issue, domestication, especially of the beautiful crown cranes, the gray crown and the black crown cranes across Africa, being domesticated and shipped out to many places in Asia and the Middle East. So sometimes that reverence just is a little too much. And so that's why illegal trade is an issue that we've had to go deeply into. And likewise, here's kind of the epitome, I guess, of where that can lead. This is a Zambian marching band for the Air Force. And these are gray crown cranes marching side by side with the Air Force in Zambia. So you can see sometimes, yeah, maybe we just revere them a little too much. So no shortage of gains we can have in seizing on that reverence, but also recognizing can be a real challenge too. Well, what else? I think another really important thing we've learned over our 50 years is the need to champion cranes and crane conservation at every level of conservation action. What do I mean by that? We focused on cranes at the genetic level in reintroducing cranes and saving the very last of the whooping cranes and other cranes that got back. Our work out at Crane City at ICF, it's been about preserving those core genetics and making sure we have a stock of cranes for the future if things go south, things go bad in the wild. We focused at the population level, recovering, securing populations of cranes, working in some of the most important places of the world where cranes occur in large numbers in their populations. We've also had to go up a level and focus on their critical breeding, feeding, roosting, migratory habitat. That includes wetlands, of course, the big wetlands cranes need, the remarkable grasslands they need, like the highlands of Mongolia for these gamazelle cranes, and the agricultural lands that they use, especially where natural lands have been lost. So critical lands, these wetlands, these grasslands, these agricultural lands, the habitat that is means so much for cranes. But the levels of conservation still go up from there. We have to think about the watersheds or the catchments that surround those places. Those little dots down in the center of your screen are gray crown cranes. They are completely surrounded by this developed watershed. In Rwanda, you'd see a similar scene. In Uganda, so critical that we think at that next higher level up about the watersheds and the people that surround their habitats. Moving up again, the regional river systems, water systems that support those watersheds and those wetlands. The scene from the Kafue Flats where we work so much to secure this floodplain that is fed by a river system that's hundreds and hundreds of miles long, bringing in waters. Well, you can go up from there to international flyways. Repeating all I just said, the need to focus on populations, on critical habitats, on watersheds, on river systems, but throughout the whole watershed, sometimes the whole flyway, sometimes cranes will traverse thousands of miles across Asia, especially East Asia, across North America. We need to repeat those conservation measures in all those places when we're trying to secure those critical flyways. And up to global concerns like climate change that we're all dealing now, our global biodiversity crisis. So we have to think at all those levels, and we have thought and taken action at all those levels in the last 50 years. And I think that's so important to think at all those different in all those different ways about conservation. It's not just the cranes, it is so much more. And despite all that, cranes continue to face chronic and emerging threats at every one of those levels, from the population level to loss of habitat, to water systems, to climate change. And I want to talk a little bit more about climate change for just a moment here, because it's a great window into the world and challenges that we face with these cranes. In my view, cranes are very much like the polar bears that we worry about. They're sort of the polar bears of the bird world, because they help us understand so many ways that climate change is affecting our lands and our future. Take the black crown cranes. They're the little dots at the bottom of your screen there. They breed in wetlands in the highlands of China, the Tibetan plateau. They breed in areas, wetlands that are fed entirely by the meltwaters of glaciers. So as those glaciers recede, and they are rapidly in those regions, where does the water come from that feeds those high wetlands? How will those cranes and other wildlife sustain in those high areas? That's an area we're focused on a lot right now. How do we keep those wetlands going? Similarly, in our northern areas, permafrost actually sustains crane habitat in the far north, like in Russia, as well as in Mongolia. These are little Siberian crane chicks that are hatching on the north slope of Russia in Yakutia, and they're very dependent on the permafrost for maintaining these wetlands, keep them healthy, maintaining conditions on the coast. Well, we talk a lot about our whooping cranes, our iconic whooping cranes. They're down on the coast of Texas, affected by many climate change factors. A big one, sea level rise. What happens as coastal waters rise as they are and continue to rise? How will it affect whooping crane habitat? How can we look at future habitats more inland where the waters may be in 20, 30, 50 years so that we can be ready for saving these iconic species and other species that need the coastal way of life as our seas change? Well, in Africa, the story is around water scarcity, some very challenging projections of water. These are black crown cranes in Chad, and there are thousands, about 14,000 we counted, black crown cranes sustained by these thin ribbons of water that persist through the dry season. What happens as we get hotter and drier, or river systems change in this region, or rainfall patterns change? Such an important window into thinking about the future of these cranes and how we're going to best sustain them as waters maybe becomes more scarce, or the timing or the depth of water changes over time. And then all these changes with water can trigger many other kinds of changes, and changes with temperatures like fires. We've all, of course, heard so many stories about fires in the last year, experience of smoke firsthand. Well, we worry about it for our cranes too, burning eggs, burning nests, burning young chicks, or molting adults that can't escape the fire. Such a big concern coming out of these climate changes. Likewise, invasive species in many places where we work, plants are coming in that have never been in areas before, whether it's mangroves marching north on the coast of Texas, or plants like this mimosa coming into new places in Africa. These invasive species can come in and really change these landscapes, maybe from warmer evening temperatures or more benign winters or whatever that may be. And it can even affect our agricultural systems. These beautiful blue cranes are on agriculture in the southern part of South Africa in the Fynbos region. They depend on winter wheat. Well, those winter wheat crops are changing with climate change as well. They're becoming less viable. It becomes drier. So again, where will these birds go that are already adapted to human-made systems but they will have to adapt some more over time. So many ways that we look at this. And of course, there's all the freak weather. Our poor sandhills don't appreciate a big snowstorm, a big heavy snowstorm in April, nor do we. But all the different ways that climate is playing out. So on the one hand, again, cranes get us to think at all these conservation levels, but we have to think and act at all these levels if we're going to save cranes. Another big one is cranes are amazing flagships for creating protected areas and helping lesser known species. So many exciting examples of this from our past 50 years and before. Of course, we know here in the US, some really important refuges were created around the recovery of cranes and have been instrumental in the management of cranes today, like Mississippi Sandhill Crane Refuge down in, no surprise, Mississippi, or Aransas down in Texas, where whooping cranes recovered. Over in Europe for the Eurasian or the common crane, incredible networks of protected areas all across the European Union to protect these birds. Here you see protection for breeding, staging, and wintering grounds, agreements across the EU to save these birds. Again, these birds have triggered remarkable conservation action. And that, of course, as I said at the beginning, has extended into many countries in Southeast Asia. We've worked to protect and create 6 national crane reserves in Southeast Asia and Vietnam and Cambodia. And these are protecting some of the last wetlands of the original Mekong Delta, so important. And then in China, again, a remarkable 46 crane reserves created and supported at the national level, protecting just millions and millions of acres of land for cranes. So through that power, we've just been able to create so many areas. In Africa, this has meant many wetlands of international importance, designated under the Ramsar Convention for Wetlands and the Wise Use of Wetlands. More than 20 African crane countries have created Ramsar sites that support cranes. Again, so important. And these sites protect many, many other species, some of them much less known, maybe less appreciated, less revered. So many species that depend on these same lands. So that's so important, the ability to create flagships. But if there's one thing we've learned over these last 50 years, it is that whether lands are protected or private or communal, it all boils down to the people who live with cranes, and crane conservation is inseparable from community well-being, and that has played out over and over and over again for 50 years. Well, back when I was a graduate student in the early 90s, in my early days with ICF, we all were hearing about the spotted owl conflict and the effort to use an iconic endangered species like the spotted owl to protect old growth forest in the Northwest. And of course that backfired in many ways. There were great gains, but also created enormous tensions with the people who live off of those lands. Tensions we still no doubt feel today. There's a bumper sticker, save a logger, eat an owl. We saw a lot of that. Well, one of the things I learned from day one in my conservation career is that's never gonna work. We can't move forward in conflict with the people who share their land with wild things and in conflict with the people who share their land with cranes. It will never work. It'll never work for people. It'll never work for cranes. So we have been deeply steeped in the sustainable development goals, in the notion that we have to integrate crane conservation with real solutions for the people that live with cranes if we want this to sustain for 50 years and another 50 years. So that means things like win-win alternatives for cranes, wetlands, and people. Well, win-win can be an overused phrase, but we have some real ones from the last 50 years. Like in Vietnam, we were working, the whole Mekong Delta was converting very rapidly into rice farming. And we knew the way rice farming was being done, the cranes and much wildlife across the region would disappear. So we got very involved in different sustainable solutions, working with local communities to try and keep those cranes in the wetlands, in the places where people can also use those wetlands and do it in a sustainable way. So we learned about the tradition of weaving mats and other products. And we worked with the community basically to scale up that work, to do it in a sustainable way so these reeds could be harvested annually, made into things people could get real benefit from. And it worked. Turns out the Vietnamese have an incredible knack for making beautiful products all out of these wetland plants, like this Leperonia reeds that grow there and other grasses. And they've done it with class. They've been able to market it internationally, make real income for the community there. and support the cranes, support restoration of those lands and the crane population in those wetlands. So it's a wonderful journey. So it's just one example, I think, of how if we really work to combine livelihoods with crane conservation, we can get real solutions. I'm really proud of this work, the work of Dr. Tran Tritt here and the awards it got, because it really is trying to get at that. We don't need another spotted owl conflict. We need solutions that work and that will bring and engage the entire public in thinking that conservation works for wildlife we love and for people. We have lots of examples where we do that. We've signed a 20-year agreement in the Kafui Flats to try and create conservation jobs as we manage two national parks in a huge area, hiring people from the local community in every aspect of managing these areas, and working with them to really support these areas as we move forward. And maybe the epitome of this work of integration of people and cranes is the work in East Africa, integrating family planning, public health, safe water, food security, alternative livelihoods, sustainable livelihoods, integrating all of that with cranes for some of the poorest communities across Uganda, Rwanda, Kenya, and doing so with this emphasis on the only way cranes are going to survive in these rapidly growing, very poor regions is if cranes and crane conservation and the betterment of people, the livelihoods of people, are hand in hand. And that is just, all of this has been such a huge lesson and a way forward for us for 50 years. And I'm so proud. You know, during COVID, we just turned that on its head in a wonderful way when our teams, our community teams, were asked to be the distributors of food back to these same communities. It just brought home to me the power of working with communities, of caring about the communities that we work with, and how utterly integral that is to the future and past and future of crane conservation. Well, another one, we talk about this one a lot. We live it. Cranes truly are ambassadors for conservation. They bring people together across political divisions. So many stories of this. This is a picture from people working together across Kazakhstan and Iran and Russia to work on the Western flyway for the Siberian crane. One of my favorite early day stories was the effort to bring China and Russia together to create new protected areas, just as glasnost was occurring, as the Soviet Union was breaking down, as China was opening up more and more. Well, they negotiated these agreements on a boat on the Amur River that sailed between Russia and China, because scientists could not go into each other's countries. So they worked, they did it by a boat, negotiated areas for crane conservation and new protected areas. That's intrepid, exciting, and how to get it done. One of the first things I did when I was with the Crane Foundation back in the early 90s, we organized a conference on cranes and did the first ever effort to bring people together who were focusing on wetlands and cranes across all of Africa. We had 20 different countries present in Maun back in 1993. South Africa had just come out of the apartheid era. They were about to elect Nelson Mandela as president. And they, for the first time, we brought together people across the entire continent to look for a future in crane conservation. Just wonderful opportunities to bring people together for cranes, for people, for global relations, for whatever you want to chalk up. There's plenty of recent examples of that too. We were earlier this year signing an agreement between Thailand and Vietnam to work together more closely for the betterment of sarus cranes and the reintroduction of sarus cranes into Vietnam, building on the great work of our Thai colleagues in bringing these birds back, which were extinct in Thailand. So exciting. And it's just great to see all these collaborations. Cranes truly do spark that effort to work a little harder to bring people together across places, across political divisions, across difficult geographies. And it's just a wonderful part of our 50-year story. But at the same time, we know political instability and conflict remains a threat to many crane species. We see that one of the most glaring examples of that right now, if you look at a map of the range of the black crown crane, one of the species we're very concerned about across West and Central Africa. Well, this other map here is just a map of the coups, political coups that have occurred and outbreaks of warfare that have occurred in the last couple of years, just since 2020. And you look across there and it's like a map of the critical habitat for black crown cranes: Sudan, Chad, Niger, Mali. across the Guinea-Bissau. These are so important places for these birds, and also for the people, the wetlands that live there, and such instability. And the work across East Asia as well. If you think about the future of the white-naped crane shown here and their migration, they are breeding up in Russia and the border of China, two countries we're really struggling with right now. How can we maintain strong connections? How can we keep this conservation work, keep our connection with the colleagues we value so much? These birds stop off in the DMZ between North and South Korea. Talk about picking challenging places. So they sit right on the border between North and South Korea, and another one of the great turbulent areas of the world. So there's one thing cranes will continue to need, and that is international diplomacy for far into the future. We're proud of our history in that, but it will be a big part of our way forward. So those are just some of the examples I could share with you about all that we've learned. Every one of these probably could be or is a webinar among the 60 webinars you can find in our collection. But I want to leave you here with some ways forward. I was a big Dave Letterman fan. Maybe you were. I always watched Dave Letterman for the top 10 list every night. Maybe dating myself a little, but they were always fun. So I've completely co-opted and stolen the old Dave Letterman top 10 list for myself. And I like to share them. And I want to share a top 10 list of some of the big challenges and innovative solutions or ways forward that I see for the next decade. I'd say for the next 50 years. But we're not going to have 50 years to solve some of these problems. So let's say for the next decade, we'll be going at these very hard and then some. And these are in no order, but here you go. Number 10, safeguarding cranes by making a real difference for these last mile communities. We are doing so much work with these communities, again, across East Africa and in parts of Southern Africa, that we call them, or they are called last mile communities, that are communities where government services don't extend, where water, sanitation, basic human needs rarely get to. And as I said before, the future of cranes in these areas depends on us making a real difference for these communities and scaling that up to meaningful number of community members, not affecting a couple hundred or a couple thousand, affecting tens of thousands of community members, so that crane conservation, wetland conservation, and human livelihoods can really work hand in hand. That's my number 10. Number 9. Securing every link in the chain of migration, as I just mentioned a moment ago, for the white-naped crane migration. That means not just navigating lands and waters as we think about those many levels of conservation, also all the communities involved and the global politics moving north to south. How are we going to keep those relations with Russia, China, keep those great colleagues, and make sure we secure every link in that chain of migration so cranes can move from their breeding grounds to critical stopover or staging places where they may need food or water or safe roosting, down to where they spend the winter, where they need all those things again. So safeguarding every link in the chain. If you miss a link, there's no future for the cranes. And so that's what we have to have, right? Well, number 8, doing whatever it takes to fully recover whooping cranes from the brink of extinction. As I'm sure all of you know, we've been so busy working for their future down in Texas and on the core remaining, the birds that survived the near extirpation of the whooping cranes 50 or more, 70 years ago. We've also been managing the birds in captivity, that critical genetic management that is so important, and working to reintroduce them, breeding population here in Wisconsin, down in Louisiana, one that doesn't migrate, even some birds in Florida and elsewhere where we've tried experiments. There's been so much effort for the last 50 years for these birds, and we've got to keep it going if we're going to bring these birds back, get them back in our lands here in the eastern U.S. and across North America. So number 8, whooping cranes, doing what it takes. Number 7, I talked before about all the challenges of climate change. We have to do our part, and that is both fighting climate change and adapting to climate change. Through really advancing nature-based solutions for cranes and people. I am super excited about work we're involved in down in South Africa, which is using the carbon markets to fund farmers to do good land use practices that sequester carbon in this huge area, huge, huge areas of South Africa where we're doing better land use. We're paying farmers to do that better land use, such as this rotational grazing here with cattle. This is also integrated with biodiversity stewardship agreements with the farmers. So this work is focusing on sequestering carbon and increasing biodiversity on these lands, doing it and funding it sustainably with the volunteer carbon market. Innovative ways to bring this kind of financing in, amounts of financing we could never have raised in the past to try and really both fight climate change through better land use, through carbon sequestration, and adapt and help communities and cranes adapt to the changing climates in whatever way we can. That's my number 7. Number 6, lots of lectures on this one, and I will only do a brief touch, but getting the water right. Water challenges, whether a lot of the ways I look at climate change is climate change just exacerbates water problems we're already having, and those water problems go way back, and they've been an important part of our last 50 years, learning and working to get the water right. We've had some exciting breakthroughs in the last 50 years in getting water out of dams and allocated to communities in Africa, in East Asia, here in the US. And a lot of that is about that balance, about on the one hand, water for agriculture and water for big agricultural projects, let's say, and for hydropower and how the water is managed for those things, versus all the people and wildlife downstream that needs those same waters for fishing, for domestic water supply, for farming, for their livestock, and for all the rich diversity of bird life, finding that balance and getting that water right. We're not going to get, just like with the spotted owl, we're not going to take away hydropower. Cranes are never going to win in a head-to-head fight for hydropower or irrigation. How could they? But it's about building a case for all the people, the communities, all the ways that water downstream, that water in wetlands benefits all of us. That's how we have to think about it. Number 5, making one of the world's major crops safe for wildlife. I mentioned the work that we had been doing in Vietnam, trying to save the sarith crane on rice fields. We're also working with farmers trying to promote organic rice that's produced less intensively but still profitably, maybe through rice noodle protection. The Thais have created a wonderful product called sarith rice that helps reward farmers who are doing organic agriculture. We need to find ways. Rice is going to be one of the great land uses of the world. We know that. But finding ways to make it more compatible with wildlife and still profitable for the people growing it is one of our biggies in the decade ahead. That's my number 5. We call it floating rice 2.0. There's a corn 2.0 here too that we need to do. Number 4, super excited about this work, restoring and managing protected areas that thrive for all. We are making long-term commitments to some of the most important places for cranes in the world. But what's innovative about it is getting the people involved in every aspect of managing those lands, generating that support so that it's, again, it's not a people versus cranes view, it's a people worth cranes. It's that, hey, people with cranes. It's people saying, hey, saving this land for the cranes has meant better jobs, more food for my family, better livelihoods, better income opportunities. That's what we have to have if we still want these protected areas to be around in another 50 years with population growth, with the economic needs of these communities. That's where we have to get to. So that's my number 4. Number 3, solving crop depredation and finding lasting peace between farmers and cranes. Well, this is where it's at. I'm showing an example of our mock-up of a crane stamp here. One of the many things we're trying to do, you may see an appeal to buy crane stamps at some point to help support farmers who support cranes. We're hoping to be rolling out a new license plate. Stay tuned for that. You can be one of the first people in Wisconsin to have a crane license plate. We're super excited about that. Finding innovative, creative ways to help farmers who bear the brunt of wildlife damage and really solve crop depredation in innovative ways and find that lasting peace so farmers can revere and enjoy cranes on their land and not feel in conflict with them. And as I shared before, that's so important here in Wisconsin, and it is so important worldwide where we even have situations of endangered cranes in conflict with farmers. It's a problem we have to solve, we will solve, we'll need your help, and we will do it. Number 2, inspiring and training a new generation of conservation leaders, diverse conservation leaders around the world. And here in Wisconsin, we have to bring the next generation into conservation. We're all losing a bit of hair these days, or lots of us are. We need to bring them in. They're so essential to the future of conservation. And so everybody in our country and across the world feels this reverence for the birds and feels it can benefit themselves and be part of their careers and their way forward. And my number 1, cloning all of you. We have to figure out a way to keep all of you for the next 50 years because you are such an amazing part, such an important part of this work. We are so blessed at the Crane Foundation to have had such amazing volunteers, donors, members. I said it before, I'll say it again. So many people that have been part and parcel of this work for 50 years, and we are so, so grateful to all of you. So I will wrap up here saying, if you care, you'll engage. If you'll engage, you'll act. And I invite you to take action with us, come visit us, join us for the past 50 years and the next 50 years. We're going to be inspired by cranes. We're going to be caring and engaging and taking action, because we're working for cranes means working for healthy landscapes and healthy people. It's those landscapes that sustain cranes, all of us, and the biodiversity we value so much. Well, you can learn more about all of this work. This one will be on the web soon. And there's so many, like I said, probably 60 from the field webinars to learn more. So great opportunities to do that. And if you're still open and free, come visit us in a couple of weeks. We have our next great Midwest Crane Festival, number 2, celebrating community and conservation right here in Wisconsin. We do that together with the Aldo Leopold Foundation. We're grateful to Culver's for sponsoring us, and save that date, November 10th and 11th, just coming down in a couple of weeks. You can join us for that. So please engage with us. We are so grateful to all of you who have made possible the last 50 years. And I just want to thank you for being part of this story of 50 years of conservation. So bravo to all of you. Thank you. Now I'm going to invite the indomitable Claire Mirandi to pop on and join me on video here, Claire. And again, as Claire comes on, I just want to acknowledge again, Claire, 39 years working with the Crane Foundation. Claire was a big part of a lot of that work I talked about, especially in her last 20 years working so deeply for the Siberian crane, the only crane in the world that is critically endangered. She's done so much wonderful work for that. So Claire, thank you for joining me for this, the last 10 minutes or so today, helping field some questions and just for everybody to get another good look at you as you look at retirement. I know Claire will still be around, but thanks for coming on and joining today, Claire. And thank you for all you've done in these 50 years.
Yeah. Thanks, Mitch. I'm absolutely delighted to relive this journey with you. As you said, and we've been there almost as long as I have. It's been quite a history. This last, the 50th anniversary celebration was a phenomenal time to reconnect with so many people that have been part of our history, and to celebrate with them and hear their stories. I'm retiring from my official job, but you can't spend a life with these people and these birds and not want to stay involved. I look forward to being a volunteer and a cheerleader and a coach in whatever way I can help going forward. I'm scrolling through the audience members here. So many of you have been with us through so many of these journeys on different levels, as members, as volunteers, as board members, as people who've helped fund our work, and some very, very key partners we couldn't have done the work in these regions without you. So welcome, and a big shout out to all of you.
Once a craniac, always a craniac, right? So
always a craniac. Yeah. So Rich, we have a couple questions. Okay. One of the first ones came early on. Is there information yet about the wood buffalo fires and their impacts on breeding whooping cranes?
Yeah, great question. As many of you may know, or maybe you don't know, but there were very serious fires up in northern Canada this year. Of course, that smoke made its way down south here as well, and very serious fires in wood buffalo. One of the things that happened that we say with great regret is actually there was damage even to the homes, fire damage to the homes of people who are working on cranes up in wood buffalo. So the first biggest priority up there was, of course, the well-being and the safety of those working on cranes. We don't know, but we will, when the cranes migrate down to Texas soon, we'll be able to get the winter count that is done every year for cranes. And we'll probably have our first good sense of whether breeding cranes were affected. If we see a reduction in chicks this year, for example, or some evidence that the fires may have harmed cranes. It was really hard to get information up there this year because of those fires. And in a moment when we wrap up, I'll talk about it. The next upcoming webinar where you'll learn a little bit more about those birds up there. But just to say, yeah, we are worried about the impact of those fires, but we will learn a lot more, at least indirectly, when we get our first counts down in Texas this year of the birds that have moved from Wood Buffalo down to the Gulf Coast for the winter. Oh yeah, good question. Yeah. Mm.
And related to fires, I don't know if people are aware, but we've also had fires, particularly the last couple of years, up in Yakutia on the Siberian crane breeding grounds. And then we've got our colleagues in Russia who we've helped support in the past, and now we're doing a lot of communication and moral support, did a lot of research on the impacts on ecology. Fortunately, it hasn't directly impacted the birds or their eggs, but just a really critical how these can spread anyway, the amount of research and collaboration we need to try and fight them when they happen.
Yeah, that's so important, isn't it? I mean, yeah. You know, it's easy to sort of watch the news and demonize these countries as our adversaries and all, but we work with such amazing people. You know, Claire has worked with people up in Yakutia and Russia with our colleagues in Russia for decades. We all have. And you know, at the colleague level, you know, ambassadorship starts with the interpersonal relations we have. You know, we have a wonderful team in China. We value so much, you know, that we want to carry on working with no matter what, you know, happens politically and all. You know, we work with people in Iran and North Korea, you know, these dedicated scientists who just want to save cranes and wetlands and work for their communities. And you know, it's just a reminder every day about the power of working with people like that and how important that is to cranes, right, Claire, to the future of these birds. So, yeah.
And I actually find that looking through my life, just we have more in common with these people sometimes than the people we run in our day-to-day life. We're all share a passion and a cause, and we find each ways to work together. Weather the different things and are quite creative. I know. Welcome, Elaine Ilyushenko. You've seen in a few of the photos, is out in our audience today and has been a real organizer for bringing people within and between regions together.
Yeah. So, well said. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Thank you. I'm glad Elaine is out there.
Okay. So we had another question here. It's a little long. I'm going to try and beat it quick. Okay. Non-migratory Florida sandhills continue struggling to maintain their population amidst rapid development. Yes, our cranes are able to adapt year-round suburban living in the daytime, although traffic, loose pets, and pesticides pose serious threats. But they and the regional flocks of migratory cranes still require wetlands for roosting and breeding. Is the ICF involved with preserving the integrity of Florida's wetlands as they are in other areas around the US or the world? If not, are you under the impression that the Florida Wildlife Commission is effectively maintaining Florida's natural resources as they pertain to sandhill cranes' well-being? Please explain. Thank you.
All right. Well, that's a big question. Well, for starters, do we care about the Florida sandhills? We certainly do. And, you know, as a little aside, but there was a wonderful story in the news that was making kind of going viral about a group of students down in Florida who took a big stand for wetlands just in the last week or so. That was a wonderful story about that caring for wetlands down there and really trying to make a bit of a scene about it, really, which is great. And I mean that in a very good way, try to raise attention about it. Well, that Florida sandhills are an interesting story because in a way they've been a prelude to what we're starting to see up here in Wisconsin and the Midwest as well. And that is as crane numbers really pick up, they are getting into suburban and urban areas. We are seeing them in our parks, on our soccer fields, in our shopping malls, sometimes as you see with the Florida chain. And that creates, you know, as I was talking about early on, whole new levels of conflict we really couldn't have imagined. You know, 15 years ago, that cranes would be so abundant to have these kind of conflicts or get into these shared spaces in places that is a little too close for comfort, like having a crane stand at your outside your car door or something in a shopping mall in Florida. So there's a lot of challenges with that. Of course, wetland conservation in Florida is a huge part of the future of sandhill cranes down there. And we know that, and we applaud all the efforts down in Florida. We are not, I would say, active on the ground with the Florida sandhills, though we know many people that are doing that conservation work and applaud it. were we asked to get involved for great need down there, we would if there was that critical need. So we're always trying to be ready to help in places where crane help is needed the most. But we are learning to live with cranes in new ways in lots of places. But the old needs, like critical habitat and the lands that surround those habitats, will never go away. So we will stay involved in all of that. So I can't comment on the Florida Commission there. We know so many people in government everywhere in the country working so hard for cranes. We have many comments, just like talking about working with Russia or anywhere in the world. Like, there are great people, really great people, trying to do their best for these birds. And we our role wherever we can is just to support them and try and collaborate with them as best we can. So there we go.
Okay. Yeah. All right. We have another question from a Vietnamese American who grew up in central Wisconsin, visited ICF about a year ago, and was quite delighted, surprised to learn about what was happening with the SARS crane, and since has gone on a bird watching trip in Vietnam and met some of our colleagues. But his comment and question are, thank you, Rich, and your colleagues around the world for all the vital work you do. You had mentioned the new collaboration between Vietnam and Thailand. Can you please say a little more about the vision and specific plans for SARS crane conservation in Vietnam, specifically places like Trem Chim National Park?
Happy to. Well, you're talking about past 50 years, you leave out 100 times what you include. So I touched on that story lightly, but that's a story very close to home for me. I my first work with ICF was actually at Trem Chim in Vietnam back in 1988. And so that's a place I treasure. Well, the newest project is really exciting. Some of you may know from past webinars and all that, we worked very hard to get Trem Chim established as a national park in Vietnam, and it is a flourishing national park. And people come from all over the country to see it because it is the best protected wetland in the entire country. So it's wonderful, loaded with birds, but it has very few SARS cranes. And the reason there's very few SARS there right now is problems up on their breeding grounds up in Cambodia. These birds have a sort of a local migration between Cambodia and Vietnam, and there are a lot of problems up in Cambodia. We're working, trying to get involved to understand those problems better and solve them. They're problems that are on places that are already protected, so they're not easy to solve, but we're getting involved in that. But in the meantime, one of the things that we learned in our early days of working in Trem Chim is that way back, SARS cranes were resident and breeding in and around Trem Chim back 50 or more years ago, before the warfare in the region. And so we're working with the Thais to reintroduce SARS cranes to Trem Chim, where there'll be a non-migratory population. They'll be breeding in and around Trem Chim. The Thais, who have done such an amazing job bringing the SARS back to Thailand, where they were extinct, are going to be helping and working with us, along with our crane captive crane department here, our aviculture team, to help work with them directly too, and do whatever we can to make that reintroduction successful. And one of the things that we're doing that I'm very enthused about in trying to make SARS crane reintroduction successful there in Vietnam at Trem Chim is that we also have funding to work around Trem Chim to promote organic agriculture and some of the things I was talking about, maybe get a SARS rice product or noodle product going in and around Trem Chim, so that as cranes move into those surrounding areas outside of the protected area, in and among the communities, those communities feel a benefit from the cranes being there, and we have healthier grown food for people and for cranes in those areas. So it's very big picture thinking, not just reintroducing the cranes to Vietnam, to Trem Chim, but also really addressing the surrounding landscape to try to have a better, healthier landscape throughout for cranes. So I'm really excited about that project, delighted to see the Thais and the Vietnamese working hand in hand with us. We're delighted with that, of course. And hoping that will go forward in the coming years. That's really taken a great leap this year with that new agreement, and I know it will go further, and I'm sure we'll get Trit and others on one of these webinars in the future talking about what's going on with that project and helping us all learn more. So thanks for that question.
Okay, Rich, I think there's so much more we could talk about, but we're running out of time. I do want to thank everyone for the fantastic comments that are in the chat. We'll have to share them with you later, Rich, but comments like, this is perhaps the most interesting presentation of all that they've heard over the years, that it's a really, really important and rich content. and someone else thanked you for the whitewater rapid trip through the last 50 years. All the power and ice you have for the next 50.
Lovely. Thanks, Claire. Thanks so much for joining. Fun chatting here. Thank you, everyone. Before we log off here, just I'll just add a couple of quick closing thoughts. I mentioned Trent Tritt before, and Andy Caven, actually, our Director of North America Programs, our VP for North America, they are going to share a webinar in about a month that you're going to love. These guys, Tritt watching whooping cranes in Wisconsin and Andy watching whooping cranes hatch up in Wood Buffalo National Park, are going to share their stories, of hardship for them and watching these birds. It's going to be wonderful. So you will enjoy that. Please do join us for that November 30th for those stories. And then this presentation and our work, again, can't say it enough, made possible by you. Thank you so much for your support for all those years. You've kept me and Claire going and George going and all the rest of us going for 50 years. We really appreciate it. Hope you'll, if you're not a member, you'll become one. Come visit us. Learn about more in these webinars and join us. So thank you so much for being with us today. Thank you again, Claire, and we'll see you all on the next webinar. Enjoy. Thank you.